Welcome back. The risen Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Welcome to our service this morning. We're sort of back to our regular routine of 9:15 in Centreville, 11 o'clock in Newburgh. I hope you figured that out this morning, and we're glad to have you here. Right, I want to invite members of the quilting group that are here this morning to come forward. And I would like to invite Don and Lorraine Yeoman to come forward. Would you like to say a few words?
This quilt here is being sold to one of our nationalities at the church, and they all worked on it. They're birdhouse quilts, and they all have sayings. I found pictures in books that I like and words from different things that I like, and they're all on here. And we put this together, and it's all hand-quilted, which makes it more valuable. And some of the things say, like the tweet sweet, birdie bed and breakfast, and so on. So it's kind of a fun quilt.
And we're excited that we have sold this quilt to Don and Lorraine Yeomans.
That's a lot of work.
Okay. So it's our first quilt, our first project, and we're so happy that it's going to a very special home, yeah, and members of our congregation. Okay, would you like to present?
Thank you.
I'm quite excited about it.
You learned a lot too.
I did.
May you enjoy it.
Yes.
May you really enjoy it.
Yeah, we will.
Also this morning, just to show a little of what the quilting group has been up to, we have the children's quilt that you may have seen before. Linda will just lift it up there. It's a quilt. If it's for anybody, if you look at it, it makes you feel better. It's a quilt with animals on it, and they all have different funny shoes. Anything you want to say about it?
I had hoped that this one would go to the Cancer Treatment Center for Children at Kingston General Hospital, but they didn't have room to hang it. So if we don't find someplace local for children or adults to enjoy it, we might sell it.
We might sell, yeah. So the home for it is still in progress. So that one. And then the one over here is the one that the group just finished. It is the material was all donated by many of you when the quilting group started, and the group has taken pieces and cut them into size and shaped them into the pattern you will see. And we had this one quilted, and it is now for sale. It is a queen-size quilt, okay? We have set a price on it. If anybody is interested, or you know of anybody interested, it is now available. We're really pleased with how it turned out. We just wanted to share it with you before it went off to be in somebody's home. So, okay.
Yes. Some of these blocks were for homework for the girls for the summer because we didn't have quilting. So they took piles home and sewed the strips together and squared them up, and then we got a pattern. That's the result.
Yeah.
So it's got a lot of history.
A lot of history, a lot of hands. All right, thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
We turn now to our call to worship. The voice of God is calling us to come with all that we are and all that we carry to worship. Come, let us worship. God calls us together to receive grace in our gathering and to reorient us again to the ways of God. Our opening hymn, get us warmed up. Come, let us sing to the Lord our song. 222. All hymns are in the red book today. 222 in the red.
Thank you.
Let us join our hearts, send our voices together in our prayer of approach and confession. Let us pray together the words on the screen. Eternal God, you are our beginning and our end. You gave breath to all living things. By your Spirit, you come among us this day, breathing new life into our familiar patterns as the gift you offer through Christ Jesus. By your grace, you open new possibilities for the world you love. So we offer you our lives in worship and in service, joining our voices with all your creatures to offer you honor and blessing, glory and gratitude, now and always. God of mercy, you keep an eye out for those who dwell on the margins of life. We confess we fail to keep our eyes open for those on the margins. We have been silent when we should have spoken up in the face of injustice. Our generosity to others does not match what you offer us. Forgive us for thinking of ourselves first. Renew our commitment to show others the kindness we meet in Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen. Hear again the good news. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only Christ. And Christ died for us, rose for us, reigns in power for us, and prays for us. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. So be renewed to live according to God's generous grace. Thanks be to God. Amen. It is great to hear some boys and girls who are here this morning. Would they like to join me up here for a moment? I know Sunday school is planned downstairs for you as well today. Is Elizabeth? William, are you going to join me too? Come on up. That's a boy. Super. Super, super, super.
So did you have a good summer?
Was it a good summer?
You did lots of camping?
Yeah, we even went to the funnest park in Niagara Falls.
You went to the funnest park in Niagara Falls. And was it really fun?
Yeah, it was a fun slide that on the moon side. That was really, really fun.
He's okay. That's good. That's really good. Oh, I know. She's not feeling so well. Yeah. No, I don't blame her. Yeah, I don't blame her. I hope she's feeling better this afternoon, and I hope you'll be okay soon.
Not looking at the stars.
Everybody's taking care of
him. My dad, when we were ill for me.
That's exciting. Have you ever been on an airplane? Not yet. I'm sure one day you will.
I think
you're too small to remember.
Yeah. We went to...
I think you went to California. Yeah. Dude, if you look around the church, can you find any crosses in it?
I remember when I went to a plane.
There's none. Yeah, there's none. Yeah. Can you see a cross anywhere in the church? Do you see any crosses? See anyone? See any? Find any crosses? Do you know what a cross looks like, William? Yeah, easy peasy. Do you see any? Is there any up here? Do you see one? Right there. There's a cross. And it's a Celtic cross. It's got the circle around it, too. But, yeah, there's the cross. See any more? Maybe. Oh, I see one. You might have to duck down to see it. But it's right on the top of the cabinet up there. Do you see any other ones maybe on me? Do you see any crosses on me? You see two? There's two more. Somewhere on me. Can you find them? Can you see them on me? Put my finger. What do you see right there? You see a cross there? Okay. And what about, let's see.
one over here. You see one over here? Right there. There's another. I got four crosses on today. Yeah. In our one of our Bible verses today.
Lovely.
In our Bible story today, it talks about picking up our cross and carrying it. And it doesn't mean that we pick up a heavy, heavy cross and carry it, but it means that wherever we go with the Spirit of God with us. And whatever the Spirit of God might call us to do, we need to be ready to do. So it's the reminder that we are Christians, we're followers of Jesus, and that we walk our life with Jesus' Spirit in our hearts. Isn't that good news? We're never alone. We have the Spirit of God, the love of God with us always and forever. Good news. Always. Always, always. Do you remember the words of the Lord's Prayer? Let's see if we do. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we're missing Robert. Robert was here this morning too for Sunday school, but he wasn't feeling well and went home. So it was really nice to see him for 2 minutes. We know he'll be back again next week. All right, let us join our voice. This is a song about how we walk and follow Jesus. It's number 567 in our red hymn books. Will you come and follow me? Jesus is inviting us to come and follow him. Okay?
Thank you. Reading today is from the New Testament. It's Mark 18 to 20. And as we walked by the Sea of Galilee, we saw two brothers, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, is his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And Luke 9:23-24. And he said to all, "If any man would come after me, let him deny himself and take up this cross daily and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake, he will save it."
We're going to, for the next few Sundays, build on the service that Frida offered last week, looking at discipleship, the call to discipleship, transformation in discipleship, community of discipleship, the assignment of discipleship. I know last week got us thinking about discipleship, and we will pursue that and learn more about it. Let us begin with prayer. Gracious God, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit. We have heard your holy word read and now interpreted. May we hear what you are saying to the church today and to us. And may we find the courage to follow your will. May these thoughts and words be a blessing to you. In Christ we pray. Amen. So I said, no, last week I was thinking about discipleship, as some have been talking about the service and talking about the number of activities and outreach opportunities that our communities of faith, Centreville and Newburgh, have been involved in or are involved in. And it raised the question of what it would have been like for those early disciples to go out and share the good news. There was no handbook or technology tool to go by, but they were to share what they had seen and what they had heard from Jesus. That still applies just the same today. What has always amazed me when Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee and Peter and Andrew, the fishermen were casting their nets and were working on their day's catch, Jesus says to them, follow me and I will make you fishers of people. Immediately they left their nets and followed him. Peter and Andrew were busy. They were doing what they knew best how to do, what they had been doing their whole lives through. No doubt they had commitments and obligations regarding their catch and preparations for the following catch the next day. No doubt they had rose early and went to work. But then Jesus says, follow me and I will make you fishers of people. And what did they do? But lay down their nets and went. The similar response is also found in verse 21. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James and son of Zebedee, and his brother John in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately, they left the boat and their father and followed him. Immediately left their father, so the family business, two sons, leaving changes everything. Immediately they went. What would it take for you to do that, to stop what you were in the middle of doing, what your lifelong career has been, and walk away? Then Jesus says to his first disciples in Luke 9, as Susan just read, if any of you wish to come after me, let them deny themselves, take up their cross daily, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. Those who lose their life for my sake will save it. Wow. Peter, Andrew, James, and John left their nets and soon would take up their crosses. They left the only life they knew for another. They didn't know anything about what they were about to do, but they were compelled to follow. And even after 3 years with Jesus and all that they had been through and taught Jesus and his disciples all that time, there was still much for the disciples to learn and to figure out. And as you recall, the discussion last week with disciples Andrew and Philip, or better known as Rosie and Jeff, they were still pondering what they were to do, where they were to go, and how they were to welcome people into the net of God's kingdom. How were they to be fishers of people for God? Were they to wait for something more? Were they to travel together? Were they just to trust that those answers would come? Sometimes it is hard enough just, you know, getting ourselves to worship or to keep the commitments that we have made in faith or to one another. What does a discipleship of a disciple of Christ look like in the world today? A disciple of Christ in the world today looks exactly like you. Exactly like you. You have laid down your nets this morning and you have responded to Christ's call to come. And you come with your questions, you come with your struggles and your desires to further understand, to grow in your faith, to continue to learn and to grow. and to balance all your other interests and obligations and commitments in your life in doing so. A comparison to a disciple might be a little like being an apprentice. Consider how an electrician or other tradesman grows in skill. They do so by looking to and following someone. We become able to do what that person does. Dallas Willard, in his book, The Divine Conspiracy, writes, "A disciple of Jesus is not necessarily one devoted to doing specifically religious things, as that is usually understood or assumed. I'm learning from Jesus how to lead my life, my whole life, my real life. Note, please, I am not learning from him how to lead his life. His life on earth was a transcendently wonderful one, but it has been led. Neither I nor anyone else, even himself, will ever lead it again. And he is, in any case, interested in my life, the very existence that is me. And there lies my need. I need to be able to lead my life as he would lead it if he were I." Jesus called the willing, not the strongest, not the most powerful, not the greatest, but the willing, knowing that his power would help, would work through them. In the same manner, the power of what Jesus will do through you and I and our family of faith will continue. It's the leadership and the strength of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, that guides us. It isn't about abilities or inabilities, it's about our willingness to respond. And did you notice that the disciples did not go seeking Jesus, but Jesus sought them and said, "Follow me," and they were willing to follow. Some of us may be struggling in different parts of our lives right now. Maybe some of us have scars from our past that may be holding us back, or you're carrying a heavy burden. You may feel like you have little to offer. James and John and Peter and Andrew were called to be disciples. And they may have assumed that they would be fishermen all their lives. I mean, that's what they knew. But along came Jesus, who by extending an invitation to follow him, is telling them that they are good enough, and he wants them. And he's willing to be with them and to put in the work to trust them with the great privilege of being his disciples. He's telling us the same. It is like the triune God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, what the triune God has done since the very beginning. We are entrusted with God's creation from the world itself to one another and to the inmost parts of our very selves. We're being invited to so many tasks that we don't think we can or cut out for or afraid to try, or they might be bigger or cost a bigger cost or a result that we may not be expecting or realize. We have been called. You are here in person through the video, but you're present. You're called, you're willing, and Jesus initiates and empowers and sustains the call. In thinking about this relationship, an illustration of this would be in John 15, the vine and the branches, where we're connected to the vine. "I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, I choose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit. Fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give." That's the type of relationship we have. God calls us and is with us always. Followers of Jesus were first called people of the way. The people of Antioch started calling the people in the church their little Christs or Christians. A disciple is literally a learner, so a disciple of Christ would be a person who learns of Christ. And along the way, we grow and change for the better as we grow in our discipleship. And discipleship just isn't about adhering to religious practices. It's not just showing up on Sunday morning. It's about who we are Monday through Sunday and who we are to the person beside us, the person in front of us, behind us, the stranger that we meet, the people, the person in the mirror. It's about how we live our lives. The challenge of the gospel message is to so love God and neighbor that we change the less desirable aspects of ourselves and at the same time change the world into the ideal that God had when he created the earth and all that dwells within it. Now it's a momentous task, but we don't do it alone. We want the generations that follow us to know of the strength, the love, and hope that Christ offers. We know that life has its many challenges and that we need that support, that guidance, and help that we can get, because there are many voices out there who can influence us in many downhill directions. As parents, grandparents, as human beings, we want the best for those who follow us, and we want the Spirit of God to be present for them. There are times when we can't be with our children or grandchildren, but we invite the Spirit of God to be present with them, knowing that will give them comfort and strength. Scott Hosea writes regarding the scripture today, he says, "There are no unimportant places. There are no places where the presence or preaching of Jesus would be wasted. Ultimately, the whole world needs Jesus, so Jesus begins by making a foray into the wider world. Place matters. Every place, every person in every place. Because in the end, the Holy Land is not over in Israel. Every place where the Spirit comes into a person's heart is holy ground. Our goal should be to keep proclaiming and living out the kingdom until the knowledge of God covers the earth the way the waters cover the seas. For then it will indeed be true once more to say, the earth is the Lord's and all who live in it." Sometimes we think discipleship means that we need to know more about the Bible. Or I could just figure out parts of my life and get that straight, then, you know, things would be more so. How does Jesus define discipleship? We can define maybe a Christian easier, but to define discipleship, interesting, before I answer that, the word Christian is used 3 times in Scripture, the word discipleship 261 times. That's where the emphasis is. Based on our readings today, Jesus would say that discipleship, there are 3 things that are true for disciples. Disciples have been called and adopted by God. Disciples are being formed by God. And disciples are empowered by God for life and purpose. I just want to conclude with a quote that I came across written by Trevin Wax in his book, The Thrill of Orthodoxy. Being called by God, of course, doesn't mean that everything will be a breeze. When we say we want to be the hands and feet of Jesus, we need to remember what happened to the hands and feet of Jesus. An interesting fact that, according to the ancient and medieval legends about the death of the apostles, the original disciples, all but one of Jesus' 11 followers were martyred, all but one, and John died of old age. Their lives changed tremendously, but their devotion to Christ, their discipleship, only grew. When we choose to enter into Jesus' story, we're learning who he is and becoming like him in character and values, and ultimately we're joining Christ where he is at work in the world, where he is at work here in Newburgh and in Centreville and in this part of the world. As disciples and disciple makers following Jesus, we get to help one another in this challenging, messy,
privileged, beautiful process of discipleship. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. In response to what we've heard, just as I am, 508 in the red. There have been times in all our lives when we have seen a need for justice, for grace, or generosity, and maybe have left it for someone else. In this present time, there is a need for each of us to share God's abundance in person, online, or through car, or in any way that we feel called to do so. Giving is a way to offer justice, grace, and generosity to our community and to our world through our mission and service fund. Our offerings will now be received. Take all the parts of our lives we hesitate to offer, and let these too be sanctified and strengthened. May your love grow among us, and may we share in your spirit of compassion. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We prepare now to offer the prayers of the people. We sing, O God, hear my prayer.
God in whom we live and have our being, we come to you in prayer, giving thanks for the occasions that we have had in the past summer months, the opportunities perhaps to travel or to restore our souls and relax. We're grateful for the weather and the beauty of creation and all its bounty. Refresh us for this season ahead, we pray. O God, Jesus faced many demands wherever he went and pressure from critics, whatever he did. We pray for all those who are feeling that way as well, for those whose work is stressful or exhausting or unappreciated. We pray for those whose livelihoods remain uncertain because of circumstances beyond their control. We pray for those who, with hard choices to make about their work, their schooling, or what comes next, about relationships and priorities, or about social policy, community leadership. May each one know your strength and guidance day by day. Today we also pray for those who this summer maybe hasn't been as pleasant or has been inflicted by pain or suffering, those who have lost loved ones or facing uncertain future or difficult diagnosis. We pray for Robert and Tanya, for Jacob, Rick, Norma, Bill, Jack, Sarah, Dave, Bonnie, Cheryl, Arthur, Luna, Albert, Angie, Hudson, Ashley, Kimberly, Rod and Donna, Carl, Wayne, Nigel, Jordan, Jack, and Trish, and all who are grieving, who are going through a difficult time, a change in circumstances. We ask, O Lord, your Spirit be with them and with those who are no longer able to be here with us in worship, but are with us in our hearts. They include Jack and Rosemary, Ralph, Gerald, Dolly, and others that we carry with us in our hearts. We pray for those who have lost their homes for whatever reason and who despairs about the climate crisis and what can be done to repair the suffering earth. Lord God, we need the embrace of your presence, each in our own way, every day. And as we soon prepare to leave the service, we ask that you walk with us and show us how to live each day as your disciple, following your way. We offer these prayers in and through Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. Looks like we're going to have some refreshments following the service. We thank Lorraine and Susan and others who have prepared them for us today. We hope you can stay. And we welcome those from Centreville congregation who have come and joined us today from the quilting group. Our hymn to take us forth, 586 in the red, We Shall Go Out, Hope of Resurrection. We go forth. As we go forth, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace always. Amen.